Good evening. Thank you for joining this first live YouTube session that I'm presenting for parents. And I would like to thank all of you who have subscribed to the channel and given the feedback. It has been really helpful all the while. In the past 4 months or so, it has been an exciting journey since I decided to initiate and progress on this YouTube channel. The main intention was sharing knowledge, and not to sound too cliched, I mean, health is wealth and knowledge is power, and sharing knowledge is going to help everyone. In these difficult times when COVID-19 crisis has struck the world badly, I think we need to spread knowledge and help perceptions in the general population, and that's what I'm trying to do. And I hope all of you will support me in this as well. I have released three videos recently on fever and its management, as well as infections. And subsequently, we followed up with one on acute upper respiratory infections and symptomatic treatments. The idea of this session is not to repeat the same information, but to go for further discussion on common questions that parents have on these topics. And I hope this session will be useful. So for those of you who have joined early, thank you for joining. And if you have any questions, do feedback. I would start with giving an overview of how our body responds to infection. So we have various organisms surrounding us. We have many germs which live on us as common cells. And all of us are familiar with the concept of probiotics and common salts as well. So these organisms are in simple coexistence. And there are many bacteria that live in our intestines, which actually have a number of beneficial effects. We also are advocating probiotics, which are helpful bacteria, which change the way our gut microbiome is formulated. So this helps us to tackle difficult situations that the gut may face. Germs can be divided into three categories. We have bacteria, we have viruses, and we have other organisms like the fungi. And previously, when we used to get a patient in the clinic, we used to say, it's only a viral infection, don't worry. But that same statement now is not received that comfortably by the families, because a viral infection now means COVID infection. And the novel coronavirus has actually changed the whole perception we have to viral infections. Of course, we always have the seasonal flu and the flu pandemics, but never before has the whole world been hit with such force as the COVID-19 crisis currently, both economically as well as in various other aspects. So we can spend a few minutes on this COVID-19 because it's a topic of current interest. And obviously, why are we so worried about this infection? So it's a virus, and the coronavirus has always had effect on human beings. Even for 30, 40 years, we know that the COVID coronavirus can cause upper respiratory infection. Most of the time, it's a simple cold and doesn't progress much. And the SARS episodes, the SARS-1, SARS-2, they were also caused by coronavirus. But the novel coronavirus is different in that sense that we have not faced such viruses in the past, and our body is naive to it all over the world. So no one has really had this infection in previous times. And the reason for it is it's basically an animal virus which has acquired an ability to bind to our angiotensin-converting enzyme receptors. And once it enters the bloodstream, because we are not immune to it, it's able to cause problems to our body. And does it affect children? Yes, it does affect children, but thankfully, the severity of infection appears to be much milder. The current CDC, the American statistics, show that though the rate of hospitalization in adults is like 160 per 100,000 people affected, in children it's only 8 per 100,000 affected. However, once they become unwell, the chances of needing intensive care is almost the same. So 1 in 3 of those who are infected get intensive care treatment. Those who are hospitalized for this infection get ICU treatment, both in adults and children. The children also carry the virus in the nasopharynx and they can spread it to whoever they come in contact with. That is the current concerns that the parents have once the schools have reopened, whether the infection will spread. Luckily, wearing masks appears to protect us to some extent. And even if we get the virus, we are getting small doses of it, which may actually serve as variolation, so to speak. So we get some exposure to the virus in milder doses, so our body is able to mount. So some scientists have gone on to publish information which shows that wearing masks regularly when we come in contact may work like a form of vaccination. So let's start doing this as a routine. Let's start getting into the habit of wearing a mask the moment we step out of the home. Try not to let your guard down. And you're not only protecting yourselves, you're also protecting the community. The less it spreads in the community, the less it's going to affect the elderly and the high-risk population. These are the main groups that actually will be affected significantly due to this problem. So moving on to the other problems, I mean, obviously COVID crisis has affected us, but just to give an overview of what fever is, once we have this baseline of organisms in the body, some of them get a little more virulent, some of them naturally have a tendency to attack. We are not naturally carrying them. So if we are exposed to these bugs, they may enter our bloodstream. It multiplies in our system. If our body defense is not able to tackle it, it can localize in a certain organ or it can spread, especially if you're immune compromised, if you're a premature baby. It can cause a severe infection. It can cause what we call septicemia. Among the areas where the infection can localize, we have areas like the lungs when we call it a pneumonia, the brain when we call it a meningitis, or if it is a virus which affects the brain matter, it's called the encephalitis. So meningitis is inflammation around the covering of the brain, and encephalitis is where we have the brain material itself getting infected. So a virus is more likely to cause an encephalitis, while a bacteria is more likely to cause a meningitis, which is more serious. And in terms of other organs, obviously, hepatitis is where the liver is involved. Gastroenteritis is where there is a tummy upset, and so on. So depending on the focus, obviously, the infection can present in different ways. The COVID infection, for example, it can cause fever, it can cause headache, body ache, and it causes runny nose due to the upper respiratory infection. It can cause a sore throat. It can cause vomiting and diarrhea due to your gastrointestinal involvement. And it can also affect your heart. In the severe cases, your lungs and heart are most affected, so you need intensive care to support the oxygenation. And when we go on to children where we have a specific multi-system inflammatory syndrome, and this is quite a serious condition, thankfully, because the COVID affecting children seriously is not that common. We do have to be alert for this condition. And once we have non-specific symptoms like persisting fever, a rash in a child, we need to do further tests like echocardiography, which will help us to diagnose this syndrome. It needs specific treatment and needs admission and monitoring. We need immunoglobulin treatment to reduce the risk of coronary vessels getting dilated in this condition. The organism is resisted by our body, and we have different lines of defense. So there is a video in my channel on vaccines and immunity, and there I've given you an overview of our immune system. So we have something called the innate immunity, which is inbuilt. We don't really need to be exposed to a certain organism to be needing to resist that particular infection. And we also have acquired immunity or active immunity. So an example of innate immunity is our skin surface, the lining of our mucous membranes, the lining of our urinary tract, the lining of our gut. So they have natural resistance abilities. They have cellular barriers which protect. There is a first line of defense, like the white blood cells which line these surfaces. If there is any breach, the blood that is supplying these areas brings in white blood cells, the neutrophils, for example, which are attracted by a chemical process called chemotaxis. And these resist the infection by a process called phagocytosis, where they kind of kill the bugs. We also have surface lining antibodies like immunoglobulin A, which can have a protective effect, which is naturally built in the system. The innate immunity has certain limitations. It is not very specific to a bug which is affecting it. And once the bug enters into the bloodstream, the innate immunity has a limited capacity. Once it gets into a certain organ, the innate immunity is not expecting it to be in that place, so it's not going to fight it. So that's where we need specific immunity to an infection, and the specific immunity is acquired. Active immunity is a process where we stimulate the body to respond to infections in a certain way. The vaccination that we give is one example for active immunity. The baby gets lots of antibodies from the mother when the baby is in the womb, and this is an example for passive immunity. So this is a very important protection for the baby in the first 9 months or so. 6 to 9 months is when the antibody levels from the mother to the baby stay in the bloodstream. The premature baby, unfortunately, is not having this exposure, so they are not as immune as a term baby, so they do have a higher susceptibility to infection. The antibodies protect the baby against any infection that the mother has had in the past or the infections to which she has received vaccines. Some of you might be familiar with the pertussis vaccine campaign in the pregnant ladies, because pertussis or whooping cough is making a comeback in many communities. The same situation applies to MMR boosters being given pre-pregnancy. Of course, MMR is a live vaccine, so you might consider giving that to reduce the risk of mumps or measles in the pregnant mothers. So passive immunization, we also apply in certain conditions. For example, in neonatal jaundice, where we have antibodies from the mother causing jaundice in the baby. If it is due to a blood group incompatibility, we can give a large dose of the immunoglobulin. I mentioned the multisystem inflammatory syndrome, where we give a large dose of IV immunoglobulin, and these help by swamping your receptor surfaces, and so the inflammation is suppressed to some extent. Vaccines are ways to give active immunization, and we are giving a particular component of the bacteria or virus. There can be live vaccines where we give a live bacteria or virus which is altered in the lab, so it doesn't really produce an infection as serious as the original one. For example, the mumps, measles, rubella vaccine we give children at 1 year of age has all the three components I mentioned, and they're all live viruses. For the same reason, a live viral vaccine should not be given to an immunocompromised person. The BCG vaccine that's given in the newborn period is also a live vaccine, and it's a modified form of the tuberculosis bacteria. It's a bovine form, and it's modified as well. So it doesn't cause serious infection, but the body is exposed to a similar type of infection. And the coronavirus vaccine that we are talking about, there are about 40 odd types of vaccine that are being tested now, and about 5 have entered into phase 3 trials in human beings. And in UAE now, we have the RNA virus vaccine, and we have different vaccines being tested by Russia and USA and in the Oxford trial as well. Let's hope that one of these vaccines helps to protect us. Of course, it's being fast progressed, and obviously the natural process would have taken much longer time, but because it's being processed at a rapid pace, let's hope that we don't face any adverse effects as well. The efficacy to be proven would take another few months or so, and hopefully the whole world will be improving after that. When I spoke about infection getting into the body starts mounting the response, and that's where I spoke about the innate and active immunity processes. Acquired immunity processes. As part of this reaction, we have chemicals that are released into the bloodstream, and some of these trigger the symptoms we face of the infection. So we can perceive that our body is not functioning normally. So we get fever, we get headache, we may get runny nose or congestion. All these are effects. So fever, for example, is a resetting of our thermostat. We have a temperature control region in the brain in an area called the hypothalamus. And this thermostat gets reset. So when we have infection, our body is perceiving that there is a problem. And one of the ways the body can fight is by increasing the temperature. As we know, the bacteria also function best at a certain temperature. We have chemicals in the body. The white blood cells, for example, are more active when the fever is when the temperature is higher. So fever is actually a protective response, and it doesn't mean it has to be suppressed. The only reason you treat fever is to reduce the risk of distress or discomfort in the child. So this I will come to during the management part of the fever. When we have other manifestations, it's because the cells that are resisting the infection actually release some chemicals. We have antihistamines that we commonly speak of, and they are nothing but medicines that inhibit the action of histamine. And this histamine is nothing but one of these components that are present in your white blood cells and other parts of the body, which are released during these active inflammatory stages. So we have resistance to these symptoms by using symptomatic treatment. I have made a separate video on what symptomatic treatments are and when you could consider treating them. Just to summarize, that symptomatic treatments are nothing but treatments aimed at reducing symptoms produced by these manifestations. So for example, if you're giving paracetamol to reduce a fever, you're giving a symptomatic treatment. If you're giving antihistamine to reduce the congestion, or you're using nasal spray to clear the nose, this is an example of symptomatic treatment as well. The manifestations of infection are by themselves not going to be damaging. The infection can damage organs. For example, if a bacteria gets into the lung, it can damage the lung tissue. It can affect our oxygenation. That's why we need oxygen. And if it gets worse, you may need further forms of support, pressure support, or CPAP can be needed, or even mechanical ventilation. Many of us are reading in the press about intensive care treatment of the COVID crisis. I'm alluding to this COVID crisis because people are receptive to that. They understand what's happening. We have heard of ECMO, which is extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, that is heard used as a last resort when your lung is unable to exchange gases on its own. And we are actually doing like a bypass where the blood is taken out of the body. It goes through an artificial machine which oxygenates, and then it's given back. So it's a temporary measure, a respite care to help the body recover from these crises. And we have damage to different organs by the infection as well as by these reactions. So excessive reaction of the body itself can be damaging, as well as we see in some conditions, for example, chronic lung disease of prematurity. So the body's reaction is called inflammation, and the inflammation is helpful to fight the infection. At the same time, these symptoms are seen as well. Do we need symptomatic treatments? The answer is yes and no. It also depends on where you're practicing, how your mental makeup is to tolerate symptoms, and obviously it depends on the physician mental makeup as well. For example, I have worked initially in India, where I trained for my medicine. I moved on to UK, where I worked for 10 years or so, and then I'm now in the UAE. There is a different threshold for symptomatic treatment reception among the families in different areas, among the physicians as well, and partly it's a mutual process where the parents feeling that they need symptomatic treatment drives a physician to prescribe something to reduce the symptoms. So if the parents are aware, if they are able to resist the urge to suppress every symptom that happens, the physicians may not need to give the treatment as well. So we have to think about which symptoms are causing trouble and treat it to the minimal essential part. So symptomatic treatment doesn't alter the course of the infection. It reduces the symptoms at that time. And if the symptoms are not significant, there is really no point giving symptomatic treatment. So you have to identify or check with your physician when something is prescribed, whether it is a therapeutic option, like an antibiotic, which is to treat the infection, or it is a symptomatic treatment, which is to reduce a symptom. And the antibiotic needs a course of treatment to complete it if it is necessary. So that's another important point which we'll address next. Majority of the infections do not need antibiotic treatment. However, if it is a symptomatic treatment, you're only giving it to relieve the symptoms. You don't need a course of it. You don't need to give it three times a day on a repeated basis for 5 days. Many parents have this misconception, so that has to be cleared as well. You only give it for the period of time that the infection, the symptom is bothering. So we have symptomatic treatments like the nasal saline spray, which is fairly benign. So currently, there are studies available that a nasal saline spray may actually clear the nose and reduce the infection carrying risk as well. So we may start discussing that on a regular basis, especially with these viral infections increasing. We have symptomatic treatments like nasal decongestants. So they are not totally safe. So we have to be careful that we don't overuse medications, because a nasal decongestant, for example, something like Otrivin drops, which we commonly use, causes rebound congestion. So the symptoms may actually worsen because you are using the medicine on a repeated basis. So we have to be watching whether the symptom relief is necessary. For example, just before bedtime, the child can sleep better and we have to give the symptomatic treatment targeting at that time, but we should be careful not to overuse it. So for example, Otrivin should not be used more than 5 days in a go. Sticking on with the nasal drops, I mean, I've seen many families using nasal steroid spray as a relief for nasal congestion. So this is a mistake, and this misconception comes up from inadequate education on the part of the physicians probably, and I would stress my colleagues to enforce this as well. Whenever a nasal steroid is prescribed, it is meant to reduce the chances of allergic rhinitis, for example, or persistent adenoidal hypertrophy. Nasal symptoms which are persisting for a long time. The nasal steroid sprays take 5 to 7 days to even start acting. So they are not going to be working as an acute relief. They are expensive medication. They have potential side effects. Of course, if you select the right patient, it will help. But if you are using it randomly in many patients, it's not going to be that helpful. So don't use the nasal steroid sprays for symptom relief. Use it only if prescribed for specific persistent nasal congestion. An example of nasal steroid spray is Flixonase or Nasonex, Avamys, and so on. So be aware of this group of medications. Don't overuse them. Next, it comes to the concept of symptomatic treatment like nebulization. So do nebulizers work? Are they necessary? So it depends on the situation you're using them. Nebulizers are expensive. The medications we use for nebulizing are expensive. And we need to clean the nebulizers on a regular basis. It does take time to prepare the nebulizer. It does take time to use the nebulizer. It's quite noisy. Many children may be uncomfortable with that noise. They may start crying. So you have to think again, is the benefit going to be worth the trouble? So there are situations like in young infants with bronchiolitis, for example, where there is a small airway. The airway gets occluded by the secretions quite easily, so nebulization might give them symptomatic relief. Again, it's not like blindly giving it because the doctor has prescribed it. If you see a benefit, you repeat it as needed. If you don't see a benefit, again, feedback to your physician, because every baby is not the same. There are babies who really benefit from, say, hypertonic saline nebulization. There are no significant evidence-based recommendations because each baby is different. When you do a research project, for example, each baby differs in their response. So overall, when you summarize the results in a study, you may not find a difference. But there are certainly some babies who benefit, and that's why we need to target. Medicines like salbutamol, for example, what we call Ventolin, are routinely used as a form in many of the developing parts of the world. However, in developed countries, the syrup form is not used because the bronchodilators in an oral form can cause side effects like fast heartbeat. We need higher doses for them to reach the lungs and effect. And obviously, we have much more efficacious, safer forms of the bronchodilators like a nebulization or the inhaler. There is a separate video on use of inhalers, and I would recommend you to watch that, because if your child does need bronchodilators, if it is due to asthma, for example, developing and causing breathing difficulties, the inhaler is a much easier option to use. For symptom relief in viral wheeze in children, in the first 2 to 3 years, again, I mentioned that the airways is narrow. Following a viral infection, you may have repeated coughing at night, which is chesty. They may benefit from some bronchodilator treatment, but it's not essential. If it's a mild symptom, it usually settles down with time. So understand why we use a symptomatic treatment and stick to when you need to use it. Coming to the topic of antibiotics, I mean, we have certain specific agents to fight infections, and antibiotics are one of the armamentarium we have. Vaccines are the armamentarium to prevent infections. We have many serious bacterial infections which have greatly reduced because of the vaccination. So we have the pneumococcal vaccine, we have the meningococcal vaccine, we have diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus vaccines. So all these have significantly reduced the infections related to that. When I was training in the early 1990s, we used to have Haemophilus influenza meningitis, we used to have pneumococcal pneumonia. Children used to come and die with such infections. But in the past 10 years or so, we hardly see such infections. So we also used to see an upper airway swelling called epiglottitis caused by the Haemophilus influenza. I have not seen any such infection in the past 15 years or so. So these vaccines have been common use from the early 2000s. So it's very important that we recommend important vaccines to be taken, because the vaccines have an important effect. Antibiotics are chemicals which are produced to kill bacteria. We have different groups of antibiotics. We have narrow spectrum antibiotics which act on a certain number of types of bacteria called gram-positive bacteria, for example, like ampicillin acts against gram-positive bacteria. We have broad spectrum antibiotics which have a much wider action. So we have to restrict the use of antibiotics for various reasons. One is the antibiotics do not kill just the harmful bacteria. They also destroy or disturb our gut normal bacteria that we have. We have normal bacteria in our nasal cavity, in the mouth, over the skin. So the our upset of this group is called dysbiosis. And normal biosis process is disturbed and it becomes dysbiosis. Dysbiosis itself produces lots of symptoms. It has been shown to produce indigestion. It can cause irritable bowel. It can cause emotional effects like depression. It may affect your mood on a day-to-day basis. And of course, our whole body functioning changes. For example, once you have had a course of antibiotics, you may not feel hungry. You may not have a regular bowel pattern. You may be prone to constipation and so on. And as a side effect of the antibiotics, we get diarrhea, partly because of this dysbiosis as well. And in a premature baby where the gut is already not developed well, giving a broad spectrum antibiotic for a long time actually changes the bacteria they are colonized with harmful bacteria. And the gut dysbiosis, which actually may increase the risk of tummy problems like necrotizing enterocolitis. So we should be very stringent with reducing the use of antibiotics. Many times parents have a misconception that antibiotics will shorten the course of a cold. Most of the colds are viral infections. I'm not talking of coronavirus here, but we have a number of viruses, hundreds of viruses, so to speak. We have rhinovirus, we have enterovirus, we have adenovirus, and many of these cause quite high fever and symptoms in the beginning. And obviously, most of them resolve on their own over 5 days or so. Unfortunately, there are some people who get a severe infection, they may need to be hospitalized even with the viral infection, and influenza is an example for that. So high-risk groups like children under 3 years of age who have older siblings going to school, those who have significant chronic problems like asthma, elderly people in the family, again, the younger children are a source of influenza to them. So influenza vaccine should prioritize these people necessarily. For the rest of us, it's an option. So obviously there is a current discussion about whether to give the influenza vaccine to everyone with the COVID. There are two ways of looking at it. One is that you are taking all the precautions which would reduce any viral infection. Most of the viruses spread by aerosol or droplet infection, which are reduced by wearing the mask, and the dose we get is reduced as well. So the severity may be less. If you don't have any risk factors, if you don't have any elderly, and even if you have a small baby, if you're taking the precautions, you don't have older kids going to school, you can discuss with your pediatrician about the significance of the influenza vaccine. And obviously, you should be alert to take it when the situation changes as needed. So that is aside from the topic. But coming on back to the question of antibiotic treatment, most of the colds are more likely to spread within the family. Viruses spread much quicker than bacteria. So if you have a family member who has a headache and nasal congestion and next day your child gets a fever, it's most likely from the same infection. There is an incubation period for an infection when the organism gets into your system and then the multiplication happens. We get what we call the prodromal symptoms. So many of us say we feel flu-y. Whether we progress to a full-blown infection depends on whether our body is able to fight it off or not. So we may just pass off with a slight stuffiness or a sore throat and a headache, a light fever for which you take a dose of paracetamol and the symptom is going away. So these are the mild cases. If you're taking a sick leave and sitting at home to drink plenty of fluids and recover, that's the next stage. And obviously, the worser cases are much low in number and you may need hospitalization for that. In terms of infections which definitely need antibiotics, so we have group A streptococcal infections in the throat. Typically, we have fever, we have cervical lymph nodes, and we have a sore throat. Other family members are unlikely to be affected. You're unlikely to have coryzal symptoms. So what we call coryzal symptoms are the symptoms I described as caused by histamine-like substances, the sneezing, the runny nose, the congestion of the eyes, and so on. So if you have a congested throat, if you have lymph nodes palpable and you have fever without the coryza symptoms, you are likely dealing with a bacterial like streptococcal. You may also have a sandpaper like rash on the skin. We call it scarlet fever with a red tongue as well. So this needs antibiotics because traditionally we have seen complications from streptococcal infections affecting different organ systems. So we have had rheumatic fever again in olden days while I was training in India. We used to see lots of children as well as adults with sequelae of rheumatic fever like heart disease where the valves of the heart are destroyed by a secondary reaction response of our body to this infection. We may have acute renal injury called glomerulonephritis, again from the streptococcal infection. And sometimes we have symptoms from brain involvement like acute movements. So obviously, streptococcal infection is worrying for that reason, and we want to treat it where we can pick it up. Of course, asymptomatic carriers may exist and we don't need to overtreat. So look at the clinical symptoms, and if it fits with the streptococcal infection, you look for a swab. We have a rapid test and we have a culture, and the recommendation is to do both actually, because a rapid test can be positive in only 40% of the cases. So where there is a strong clinical suspicion, we may send both the culture and the rapid test. And actually, it's not dangerous that it will progress quickly. So you're safe to wait for the result of the culture unless the child is definitely symptomatic. The other category of infections that commonly need antibiotics is where ear infections in young infants. So beyond 1 to 2 years of age, even a ear infection can be monitored because viruses predispose to ear infection. In young infants, one of the reasons we get ear infection is because the eustachian tube, which is opening from the inner part of the mouth to the ear, it ventilates the middle ear. So it is more short, and it is if a baby is feeding, lying down, there is congestion of the eustachian tube already. When we have a congestion of the airway due to the viral infection symptoms, the eustachian tube blocks, so the middle ear doesn't get adequate ventilation. The fluid collects there. And of course, the bacteria can migrate from the throat to the ear, and this may localize as ear infection. So when physicians examine the ear, we're actually looking for redness in the tympanic membrane, which is a sign of middle ear congestion, and bulging may be there. And sometimes the pus breaks out of the middle ear. It can be scary for the families, but actually it's not serious in majority of the situations. You give the antibiotic, this membrane will seal off. Sometimes persistent blockage of the eustachian tube leads on to fluid in the ear called glue ear, and this can lead to hearing impairment. Adenoid enlargement in young babies and infants can be a reason for glue ear as they grow. And if we have concerns about their hearing, we should get it checked as well. So ear infections in young infants, we should consider antibiotics. Urinary tract infections are another group of infections where we prescribe antibiotics. So if the child presents with persistent crying, if there is irritation while passing urine, if there is increased frequency of urine in girls, it may just present like increased frequency of urine with possibly some discomfort. They have urgency while they pass urine as well. So these are signs that, and girls are usually more prone to urinary infection than boys. So in the first year of life, some boys may get urinary infection as well. But in girls, because of the short urethral passage and if the hygiene is not proper. So one of the important advices parents have to stress on is that cleaning is always from front to back, because the bacteria in our gut contaminate the anal area. And obviously, when we bring from back to front, the bacteria can enter the urethra, which is just in the neighboring part. So we should be careful. And if an infant is wearing nappies, change the nappy regularly. Don't allow the stool to stay for a length of time, because it can increase the risk of infection again. In terms of gut infection, very rare that we need antibiotics. So we have specific infections, Salmonella, for example, in young infants, or if there is very high fever with Salmonella, we may give. But most of the salmonellosis presents as mild dysentery. Some blood in the stool may be there, but in the older kids, there is no need. If there's no significant fever or other symptoms, it will resolve, and using antibiotics may actually increase the duration of the bacteria being shed and spread in the community. So one of the reasons we get Salmonella gastroenteritis is uncooked or partially cooked eggs and meat. So we should be careful that we cook it appropriately. We have seen quite a few cases of Salmonella recently, as due to the lockdown, there is more infections related to these rather than the typical viral bugs. So we do get the rotavirus vaccine to reduce the risk of rotavirus infection. But the other common viruses which cause gastroenteritis have reduced, and we are seeing some dysentery cases more. When you're traveling to a developing country and you develop a dysentery, you have to think of an infection like amoebiasis. In terms of gastric upset, gastroenteritis, so to speak, we have vomiting to start with in the acute phase. Usually the vomiting is in the first day of the infection. After that, vomiting is not a significant symptom. You do have to give anti-emetics to reduce the vomiting if the vomiting is persistent and the child is not able to tolerate foods. Injections are not necessary. You can give the oral medication if the child can manage the vomiting. We do have some suppository formulations which may be helpful when the child is vomiting as well. When the loose stool starts, it depends on how severe it is, whether the frequency of loose stools is significant. So if the loose stools are persistent, the child is at risk of dehydration. So that is a main concern we have when there is gastroenteritis. So maintain the hydration. Oral rehydration solutions are needed if there is a significant loss, because we not only lose water, we also lose electrolytes. So this is an important aspect we should look at as well. So this is part of the symptomatic treatment. So giving symptoms for the fever if there is there, vomiting if there is vomiting symptoms, and oral rehydration to maintain the hydration. Sometimes the parents are helpless in the sense that child refuses to take, then we have to sit with the child and give sips of fluid. Admitting the child for hydration is not necessary unless the child is really dehydrated. And many times you can watch my video on picky eating, where parents create an attitude in the child that resisting is okay. So from the beginning, if our parenting and approach to discipline is good, we may not face that as well. So I think there is one question from Ganga about prolonged use of Montelukast. Obviously, I should say that there is an increased use of Montelukast like Singulair in the community, and we do use it for indications where it may not be definitive. So the definitive indications are where there is persistent childhood wheeze like asthma, where you are going for one of the lines of preventive treatment. Not the symptom relief, you are going for prevention. We have the steroids, which are the inhaled steroids. We have the Montelukast-like agents. So you can give them for a prolonged period in definite indicated cases. So don't use them just for persistent nasal congestion. Allergic rhinitis is one of the reasons where you may consider if the response to the nasal steroid is not adequate. So re-evaluate why you are using it. If it is necessary, it can be given for a length of time. So be aware of the indication for which you are using it, whether it is needed to be continued. So again, we will look if there are any other questions. Thank you everyone who have commented that you found it useful. I think it's about 40 minutes now, and we must be reaching the threshold of our listening capacities. I've given an overview of what infection is, how our body reacts to infection. A few brief points on COVID-19 infection fitting the current crisis, and symptomatic treatment and why we should avoid antibiotics. Of course, before we close, I can mention a couple of words on probiotics. So probiotics are actually bacteria which are selectively prepared. They have been shown to belong to a helpful group. There may be a single bacterium, or it can be a group of three or four groups of bacteria. We have bifidobacterium, we have lactobacillus, we have bacillus clausi, and so on. So we have different bacillus species. So we have different types of bacteria which can be produced. These are stringently produced. You may have the bacteria as a live bacteria, or you may have the spore form which actually releases the bacteria in our gut. So probiotics are used in situations where you expect gut dysbiosis, or you think that gut dysbiosis may be causing a problem. So we can consider it along with the use of antibiotics, where antibiotic use is essential to reduce antibiotic-induced side effects. We can use to treat gastroenteritis where you have a persistent symptom. In premature babies, there have been studies which show that using a probiotic might reduce the risk of necrotizing enterocolitis. Whether probiotics help with colic is debatable, and some colleagues have recommended Lactobacillus reuteri or similar probiotics for colic. Some benefit may be seen, but if you're breastfeeding, it's unlikely to give much benefit because breast milk gives you the natural probiotics that you need in a good dose, and the mother's own bacteria get into the baby, and this is the best. Same way, cesarean delivery is much better than vaginal delivery is much better than cesarean delivery because it has been shown. I would recommend all of you to watch the video on probiotics in cesarean because when we are delivered by cesarean, our body gut microbiota development is a totally different pattern. When you deliver vaginally, you get the mother's vaginal microbes, which are similar to the mother's own organisms. When you deliver by cesarean, you may get the surrounding bugs more than the mother's own bugs. And this has a permanent impact. So studies have shown higher risk of obesity, higher risk of hypertension, and so on in the babies who are born by cesarean delivery. So you have lifelong impact. Even the way we regulate ourselves, the way we eat, our satiety, our overeating. So everything is regulated by such symptoms. So I see Dr. Sunita is here as well. So welcome, Dr. Sunita. And I hope you would agree that cesarean deliveries are to be restricted to where it is essential. As a responsible obstetrician, you would advocate that. And I have other colleagues who are present as well. And I do encourage all of you to discuss the negative effects of cesarean sections as well, where possible. So I think we have had a fairly lengthy session, and I hope it is useful. And I thank you for your feedback and comments. I'll just check one final time if any questions. So I think there are no more questions. In case child is having slight cough. Okay, so Hale, thank you for the question. And obviously, mild cough can happen in babies, often due to mild reflex-like symptoms. Even a newborn baby in the first few days when they're trying to swallow properly, a mild reflex may happen, or if the milk flow is fast, the baby may cough. So that is the earliest cough we have. And the nasal congestion is also normal after the vaginal delivery. So in a newborn baby, don't worry about that type of cough. It doesn't mean the baby has a cold. Of course, if the baby looks unwell, you do have to get it checked. But if baby settles down soon after, you don't need to be worried. In terms of in an older child like your baby, close to 1 year of age, if the cough is mild, it can mean a mild viral infection, but it may mean some sensitization to dust in the environment or allergy as well. So when you're cleaning the house, for example, if you're doing some cleaning where dust is generated, cough may come due to mild allergy to the dust. If you have traveled outside, especially with season changes, there may be pollen in the air, and the child may react to that. Watering eyes, rubbing the eyes, and sneezing may happen. So that is a mild cough as well. So if the symptom relief is significant, you can consider an anti-allergic for a brief relief at that time. Cough suppressants are not to be routinely used. Again, you can refer to my talk on symptomatic treatment, because cough has a natural mechanism to clear the secretions that we have, or the irritants in the airway come out when we cough. I know it is disturbing, and if it is persistent, you can give symptom relief at that time as needed. Again, don't use sedative medications to babies under 6 months of age. So most of the cough medicines or cold medicines have some sedative effects, and avoid using systemic decongestants. So there are many combination cold medicines which have systemic decongestants like pseudoephedrine. So even though the child is relieved of the symptoms quite quickly, especially because pseudoephedrine dries up your nose quite well, it can have side effects on your heart. And so many countries do not allow these formulations anymore in young children. So under 4 years of age, ideally you should not give. If you do give, give one dose or two, not more than that. So any other questions? Thank you, Biju. Thank you, Roshni. And thank you everyone else, Raki and Renuka. Renuka is my colleague from medical college. So she's a consultant ophthalmologist. Thank you. And I think with this, we will close the session. The recording would be available, and I hope you can share it with your friends who might find it useful and informative as well. And obviously, good night and have a nice week ahead. Thank you.